Jeremy Kahn approached me several months ago and told me that he had done this recording 15 years ago of it called Most of a Nickel, which is the music of Kurt Weill's Threepenny Opera. And they never did a CD release concert. And so this music has never been performed in public. In fact, backstage you said, barely in private. So this is the first, you are hearing a world premiere of the, of these incredible arrangements. And believe me, I heard, obviously we're here for the sound check. It's unbelievable. So I'm not going to tell you any more about it. We're just going to take a listen to it. This is Jeremy Kahn on the piano. That's Larry Kohut on the bass, Eric Montzka on the drums, and our pal Jim Gailloreto on saxophones and flute. And please welcome the Jeremy Kahn Quartet. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Welcome. As Steve said, this is the first time we're playing this music since we recorded it. When was that? During the Clinton administration or something? And we appropriately started with a piece called Overture. And we're splitting tonight's proceedings. The first half will be stuff from the CD, written for the Threepenny Opera in Germany in the late 20s. And then the second half will be Kurt Weill's, some of his better known compositions after he moved to the States. So we're going to continue with a song called Tango, which parenthetically is called The Ballad of Immoral Earnings. Did a little research. Threepenny Opera was originally called a pimp's opera, but they changed it. So they cleaned it up a little bit. So here, for your enjoyment, is a tango. I don't think I needed glasses when we recorded this 15 years ago.
Thank you.
Why, thank you. Jim Gailloreto playing the alto flute there. Rarely heard, very exotic. Now what do you got? Oh, soprano sax. You're not getting extra for all those instruments. So. You read the contract. This next tune is called Pirate Jenny. And I like to think of it as this is sort of our tag team song. And by that I mean it's mainly a series of duets that get sort of passed around. I gave these guys a scorecard so that they'll know who's supposed to be playing when, and we'll hope for the best. Luckily for me, I don't have to start. It's Jim and Larry Kohut over there on the bass. He's very good. Show him how much you love him. And while I'm at it, Eric Montzka is on the drums. Okay, so here's Pirate Jenny. Thank you. Thank you. That's Pirate Jenny, wherever she is. The next one is called Liebeslied, which translated is love song. And, you know, I'm usually not a big fan of prime numbers. You know, I don't like playing in weird time signatures. For some reason, this one is all over the map. And the one after this is even worse. So, just a little disclaimer. But at least this one is slow. So, this is Liebeslied, which a big love song between Mack The Knife and some woman, I can't remember. I did this show a really long time ago. But I didn't really pay attention to, I know there was somebody named Mack in it. Carried a knife, I guess, I don't know. So here's Liebeslied. Thank you. We can fix that in post-production, right, Steve? So this one, what should I say about this one? This is Mack the Knife, first of all. I wasn't sure exactly how to treat this because we did sort of weird stuff with all the other ones. There was no point in playing Mack the Knife like Ella Fitzgerald or Bobby Darin. Maybe we'll talk about this in between a little bit more. I will only say that there's much more weird math going on here. What you're about to hear is probably the single most important factor in the fact that most of my bourbon got finished off after each of our rehearsals, probably because of this one. So I think these guys still wake up screaming because of this one. But don't let that affect how you react to it. So here's Mack the Knife. Thank you. Thank you. Not a happy person. Old McKeith. We're going to continue with another one from Threepenny Opera. Bertolt Brecht and Kurt Weill and Lotte Lenya, the whole crowd. This is Solomon's Song. It's going to start with Larry Kohut playing the bass, right?
Okay. Whatever you say.
Okay. So, here we go. Thank you. We're going to do a couple more. This next one is called Barbara's Song. Like I said, we're going to do three more. Where would I be without you, Larry?
More successful, no doubt.
That was actually a rhetorical question. Cannon Song, which is sung by some drunken soldiers, as I recall, and the only lyric that I remember has to do with beef tartare, eating raw beef. Beef steak tartare. That's all I remember. That's all you need to know, really. Cannon Song. Raw beef shot out of a cannon, maybe. I don't know.
Minor league baseball.
I think we're onto something. Starting with military stylings of Eric Montzka.
That's a great question. Let's go with eight.
Yeah.
Thank you. Beefsteak tartare. I should take a brief moment and express a few thank yous, though I'll sprinkle them in along the way. But to Larry and Eric and Jim for making this music come alive. I didn't really exactly know how it was going to sound. And like I mentioned in my liner notes, it was never in danger of being over-rehearsed. I think we we got together maybe once every 10 months or something over the course of 2 or 3 years, and then we said, what the hell, let's just go in and record it. And kept kind of the same philosophy this time around. we got together a couple of times, and trust me when I say that these are like three of the heaviest musicians that I know, and and to see them sitting there backstage, quietly terrified, was interesting.
Made you feel good, didn't it?
Yeah. It made me wonder if maybe I should be terrified too, which I am. Okay, so now two more songs. This one is called Barbara Song. It's my sister's name. Probably not after her, though.
Thank you.
Thank you. We're going to finish this set out with a song that was a duet by the comic couple. It's called No They Can't. It's got some really long German name that I don't know. Anstatt or something, I don't know.
Yeah, that was it.
Aren't you from there, Eric? Didn't you grow up in Germany?
No.
No. Different Eric Montzka, probably. Here's No They Can't. Thank you.
on behalf of Jim, Eric, Larry, and me, thank you so much. We're going to take a short break. The bar is open. I know that's where you'll find me, and we'll see you in a moment. Thank you.
Jeremy Kahn Quartet, ladies and gentlemen. Jeremy Kahn, Eric Montzka, Larry Kohut, and Jim Gailloreto. Bar is open. We'll see you in a few minutes with a little conversation and more music.
Hello.
Hi, hi, Jeremy. So, as I mentioned before the show, we have a brief conversation at the beginning of the, as part of the show, and it becomes wrapped into the radio show that we broadcast later on. This show, by the way, will probably be broadcast in a couple of months. We have several shows in the queue. But I'm so excited to have Jeremy here that we talked about doing this. God, it was quite a while ago that this first came up, and not 15 years ago, but it was several months ago. And so I'm really thrilled that we were able to find a date to make this happen. And I will admit that I don't know that much about Kurt Weill, and I did a little bit of research, you know, leading up to this. But he was really a. I mean, do you know much about him?
Not tons, but he wrote a lot of theater music. But he there's some symphonic music as well. He was, I guess, the rough equivalent might be George Gershwin.
Yeah,
he was sort of all over the map.
Right, I was thinking George Gershwin and Leonard Bernstein. That sort of, you know. Songwriting, it seemed to me, from the little bit of research I did, songwriting was just one of those things that he did, but he was much broader, and wrote orchestrally. Now, you didn't just write tunes, you know?
Right.
And so a real broad talent. Why do you think that his music has endured and sort of keeps popping up as, you know, as standards? Why did some of his stuff last?
That's a really good question. Next question. I think in the case of what's interesting to me is that his earlier stuff that he wrote in Germany is a lot more adventurous. And the first time I encountered it, it seemed very modern to me, except for the rhythms, which. In the case of this show, a lot of it is sort of the German idea of swing at the time, which is rather heavy-handed. So about the only thing that I adjusted for the Threepenny music were the rhythms, the grooves.
Uh-huh.
But I think the melodies are really strong. And then, as you're going to see, with the stuff that he wrote when he came to America. He suddenly became a little bit more Broadway-ish and did write kind of pop form standards of
yes.
the day.
Well, you know, I was trying to put him into some historical context. He died at 50 years old. He was born in 1900 and died in 1950. So
it's easy
like
to remember, yeah.
Yeah, easy to remember. And so when he was 28 in 1928 was when he wrote Threepenny Opera, right?
Right, very precocious.
But yeah, how about that? 28 years old, he comes up with that. And then a few... 5 years later or something, he leaves Germany because his parents are because the Nazis came into power and just got out.
Mm-hmm.
But then made his way here, and he seems to have been influenced by what was happening here, but he carried with him so much of his own life and culture. And
yeah, it still doesn't sound like anybody else, but it's
right.
But he definitely got Americanized when he started writing for Broadway. And I did a little research myself, and the first American production of Threepenny Opera was a horrendous flop. It closed after 13 performances or something like that.
Wow, wow. So he was not immediately recognized or
No, maybe by the time he came over here, he had more of a name, but when it was produced in the States for the first time, it was still the early 30s, so he was still in Germany.
Oh, so he wasn't, got it, so he wasn't already here. And why did you choose this music? Why? How did you get so familiar with it that you wanted to do a whole CD of it?
I played a production of it right when I was in college, or right out of college. I was hired by a theater company on lovely Cape Cod, Massachusetts.
Oh, wow.
And they did Threepenny Opera, and this is the first time I ever encountered Kurt Weill's music other than Mack the Knife, I suppose.
Uh-huh.
And I was immediately drawn in by the entire score, and it was just sort of kicking around in my head for literally decades. And I started, I bought a copy of the score and started messing around with it. And I thought, you know, I think I could adapt this to, you know, a quartet, a jazz quartet, the format that I'm familiar with, and came up with this stuff.
Wow. And then it took you a while after that to actually record it.
Yeah, yeah, you know, those three guys, whatever their names are, I can't remember. Mo, Curly, and Larry or something.
Yeah.
We all live very complicated existences. And it's hard, you know, time gets away from you.
Sure.
And scheduling rehearsals is very hard. And there was no timetable on it, but we eventually made it happen just through perseverance.
Wow. So, well, I can only say that it's really a thrill to hear this stuff and to hear it. It's so nice to hear it in its entirety and not, you know, here's a piece from it. To just hear the whole suite is really, really lovely. And what a monstrous band. These guys really.
Yeah, they're okay.
Yeah. Larry Kohut, Jim Gailloreto, and Eric Montzka are just extraordinary musicians. And
thank you for presenting this. This is everybody says that the acoustics are so great in here, they can hear everything, and this is a great piano, and I've played here a handful of times over the last few years, and it's always a pleasure to come back, so thank you.
It's always a better night when Jeremy Kahn's at the piano, let me tell you.
Oh.
And let me also say, this is one of the cool things about this particular evening is that, and I actually didn't know this till I arrived tonight, the fellow who recorded this CD is behind the board.
That's Sam Fishkin
back there behind the board. So the guy that's making it sound so good in the room is the guy who actually recorded the record. So. Ta-da!
That's for you, Sam.
So thanks to Sam Fishkin both for making a beautiful recording and for always making it sound so great in the room. And I'm now going to leave the stage and let you get back to some
music. Okay, well, thank you, Steve.
Thanks.
Paging Jim, Larry, and Eric to the bandstand area, please. So, like I said, this section of the evening will be comprised of songs that Kurt Weill wrote with a variety of lyricists after he moved to the States and started writing for Broadway shows. And I'm guessing you might recognize maybe one or two of the ones that we're going to do. The first one is a beautiful song written in 1941 for a show called Lady in the Dark that starred Gertrude Lawrence, who was a big star of her day. The lyricist is Ira Gershwin. So this was really only a couple years after his brother George had passed away and was starting to collaborate with some other folks. And this is a beautiful song. So like I said, these are the American songs. They're a lot simpler, although of course I've made them unnecessarily complicated. When you see these guys looking around like deer in the headlights, I won't be able to help them out. But this is a beautiful song called My Ship. To self, it's 2 pages long.
Thank you.
Thank you. That's my ship. We're going to flip ahead 6 years, 1947. This is from a show called Street Scene. And I noticed that he collaborated with not just lyricists, but poets, including Langston Hughes on this one. And this is a song called Lonely House.
Nope.
Right? No. Am I lying?
Yeah.
Are we supposed to be doing Speak Low? Yeah.
Speak Low.
Never mind. Pretend like you didn't hear that. Here's a song from a show called One Touch of Venus from 1943. Mary Martin was the star of it, and it became a movie with Rita Hayworth. And this is one of Kurt Weill's enduring standards. It's called Speak Low. That's right, no bass solo, Larry.
Yes.
Wow, who knew?
We're all happier now. Thank you.
Well, thank you. So when I say the name of the next tune, pretend like you never heard me say it before. So here's a song called Lonely House.
What?
Yeah. Oh.
Never played it before.
Wow. Academy Award. Langston Hughes wrote the lyrics to it. What's it from? What's it from? Oh, I have it written. Oh, it's from a show called Street Scene, 1947. So hope you enjoy Lonely House.
Thank you.
Thank you. That's Lonely House. Creepy house a little bit, too. this song, this next one we're going to do is from the same show that my ship was from. So Ira Gershwin wrote the lyrics that you won't be hearing. To be perfectly honest, we stole this arrangement from a Chick Corea record, and if Mack the Knife was our scary moment in the first half, the end of this song is our scary moment in the second half.
Yeah.
Shouldn't really tell the people this, should I?
No.
Because it's going to go well.
It's going to go great.
Yeah. What could possibly go wrong? If anything bad happens, like if we're not together, it's Eric Monska's fault. No. You're doing great, man. Okay. So this is new from 1941. Not exactly new, but it was new. This was new.
Thank you.
Thank you. This is new. Got a couple more left for you. Thank you so much for coming. Really appreciate it. We know there's probably something good on TV tonight, but no, there isn't.
Oh, you need some space, don't you?
Oh, this is where Larry and Eric will leave the bandstand area and perhaps think about what they've done. Probably not. This is a beautiful song, and do I have anything that's really fascinating to know about this song? This is from a show called Lost in the Stars. We're going to play the song of the same name. The lyrics were written by Maxwell Anderson, is based on the novel Cry the Beloved Country, and we have an odd sonic party trick that Jim and I are hoping will work. He's going to play little mini cadenzas into the open piano, and it's going to produce a magical, transformative cloud of sound. Or not. Thank you. Thank you, that's Jim Gailloreto, Lost in the Stars. Again, thank you so much to Steve and Bia and Sam Fishkin for helping us out here, and to fabulous Jim Gailloreto over there in the front. The only one that wore a necktie, making us all look like slobs. Eric Montzka on the percussion. Larry Kohut on the bass. Anybody ever see The Treasure of Sierra Madre? Really good song. And a really good movie. Not a good song. The Treasure of Sierra Madre. I'm just worried, it's a work in progress. The old guy that was one of Humphrey Bogart's tormentors was the filmmaker John Huston's father, Walter. And he was in Knickerbocker Holiday, which Kurt Weill wrote. That's why we're doing it tonight. And Maxwell Anderson was the lyricist, and Walter Huston introduced this song. It's going to be our final offering for you. We thank you so much for coming out tonight. This is perhaps Kurt Weill's most famous, maybe aside from Mack the Knife, but we won't count that one. So here for your enjoyment is September Song. Thank you. Thank you, Sam. Thank you, Steve. Thank you, Mia. Thank you to Larry, Eric, Jim. We'll see you in 15 years.
That's the Jeremy Kahn Quartet right there. Jeremy Kahn, Jim Gailloreto, Larry Kohut, Eric Montzka, and spectacular music by Kurt Weill.